Prairie Mosaic is funded by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4, 2008. The North Dakota Humanities Council, a nonprofit, independent state partner of the National Endowment for the Humanities. The North Dakota Council on the Arts. And by the members of Prairie Public.
Hi, I'm Bob Dambach, and welcome to Prairie Mosaic, a patchwork of stories about the people and places that contribute to the arts, culture, and history in our region. On this edition, we'll experience community theater in the Goose Capitol of the North, learn who our seed savers are, tour a museum devoted to snowmobiling, and enjoy the music of a woodwind quintet. Darla Julin's love for baking started as a child when she received an easy bake oven as a Christmas present. In 1996, she took that passion and opened Fantasies in Frosting. Today, this award-winning cake artist still loves creating masterpieces to help her many customers celebrate the special occasions in their lives.
My background in baking and cake decorating started when I was a child. I got an easy bake oven when I was about 8 years old. And I still have that. I never wanted to work outside. I never wanted to do anything else except bake and cook. Fantasies in Frosting got started in 1996. I had a few deaths in the family, and it really made me evaluate my life. I decided if I don't open up my business now, I never will. And that's how it got started, and I've been doing it ever since. So I'm starting out with the fondant here. We got this fondant cake for this weekend. I'm hoping this is gonna be enough for the bottom tier. I'm gonna put it on the sheeter, and the sheeter flattens it out so I don't have to do that work by hand. Okay, so we've rolled it out, and now we're gonna get the bottom tier out of the cooler and put the fondant on. Carefully, we've got to pick up the fondant and drape it over the cake. Now we got to smooth the fondant out. I start with my hands and then I use a fondant smoother. This will get all the air bubbles out, or as many as possible. Square cakes aren't always my friend. I've been known to do one of the layers over three times because I wasn't satisfied with it. What I'm going to do now is trim off this excess, and then I'll do some more smoothing. It doesn't look like there's any air bubbles, so we did good this time. When it comes to decorating, for instance, the cake behind me, it would take me about 8 hours of decorating time to finish that cake. Plus, you're looking at the baking time and prep time too, so. Some cakes really take a lot of time to do. Now our next tier is going to be a 12-inch square. This is the support system. It's a metal ring, and then there's going to be four pegs on each of these screws. And that'll go into the cake, and that's what's going to support the cake so it doesn't fall down. Push it down. It's got to be flush with the cake. And it is. All right. This bottom tier has the quilted look on there. You either can do it by hand or you can get a grid like this. Press it into the fondant with your fingers and then just go over the ridges and it'll impress right into the fondant. And then you have to match your pattern. A lot of these tools are made by cake decorators that have done this stuff for years and needed items to speed up the process. Alrighty, we're done. We make anywhere from 100 to probably 130 weddings a year, and birthday cakes, all occasion cakes, at least 600 a year. People ask me, what's my favorite cake? And then I tell them, well, I don't really eat cake. I taste my cake, but that's about it. I don't eat cake just because I'm around it all the time. But if I'm going to have a piece of cake, it's going to be carrot cake.
This is a level, and the little bubble will go in the middle when it's level. It goes too far one end or the other, it's not.
All right, we're done stacking. Yay! Nothing else, as far as work experience, has given me as much joy as this has. You can work with people during the happiest times of their life, their wedding, birthdays, anniversaries, graduation. People are always happy when they're getting a cake, so that's what makes it so great. And when people come back to you and they say, oh, my cake was so good, and you should have heard all the people, you know, say that the cake was just great and was so pretty, I mean, that just, it just makes your day. So I can't imagine doing any other type of work except this.
Middle River, Minnesota bills itself as the Goose Capitol of the North, but it's also known for its vibrant community theater, which performs in an old remodeled train depot.
Thank you very much.
It's open seating?
Yep, open seating.
Right, yeah. Liz, it's Audrey, where's my shirt? What?
You said that? Where's Lenny?
Oh, he's coming. He's moving pretty slow. He's got whiplash. The seatbelt went right around his neck. Pulled him straight up. I left him dangling.
Oh! We have a sellout every night, and people enjoy it, and they look forward to it.
I'll be right back.
I'll throw some slippers on Charlie.
Our community likes history, and that is another thing. We want to keep our theater as original as possible. That's why we've kept the big sliding door for the audience to come through. We have the dressing room is the original passenger area.
Oh, there is a lot of pride, yes. I think what it means for a lot of people is that we're not as small socially, if you want to say it that way, than the stigma might be for a town this size. I mean, the talent that we see here, quality of the productions, we'd put it up against anybody else, I think, on a bigger scale.
Any ringing in the ears?
Oh, God. Tell him no!
Theater has a seating capacity of 80, and it's a cozy 80. I mean, we're packed pretty tight in there, and typically it is a sold-out crowd, so over the course of six nights, we're looking at close to 500 people that attend each performance, each Goose Festival.
This building is not the original depot. The original depot was burnt by was struck by lightning in 1904, and this particular building was brought down from Plume, Canada, located over northwest here along the tracks. So then in 1989, we put up a foundation and got the ground ready and moved the theater over to its present location.
I don't know the truth. Charlie was mumbling the whole time.
In 1990, we had our first production for the Children's Theater, and we did Hansel and Gretel. We've had a lot of improvements that we've done with the building. We had some board members and volunteers that built a deck on. The community club gave us the barbershop, so that was moved over, and that, of course, is our concession stand now.
We have gotten more grants than this in the past, but this last one was, it was part of the Minnesota Legacy Arts Grant. It was for $9,000, believe it or not. Then we were able to utilize part of it for the children's production. The other part was for the renovations on the outside of the theater. The inside, it's been, over the years, a lot of stuff has been done. Obviously, that's been painted. We've had seats that were donated by a church. We've recently been able to get new carpet on our stage and paint and siding and insulation. Kind of a labor of love, I would guess you would say, and a lot of volunteer efforts that have been put into the inside.
I am so happy to welcome you to the 37th Annual Goose Festival in Middle River. Middle River, a small town with a big heart and big ideas. Now let's have some big time fun. Welcome.
Goose Fest, we're in our 37th year. community celebration that kind of just celebrates fall, but it's grown to the point where people are coming from all over the country. I mean, we got people from Washington that religiously come here every year too. Town grows from maybe 350 on a good day to, I know we get over 3,000 people in here. It's supposed to signify the opener of goose hunting season. The Goose Festival play is usually an adult comedy type play that we put on during the Goose Fest. Typically, we like to keep it open to anybody willing to give it a try. We're always looking for new things like that. And as far as acting, that again is open to anybody in the whole community. They come from as far as Thief River, further north than that. We've got them from out in New Folden area, but it's the local talent pool is incredible. And that lends itself to some pride that everybody in the community seems to share. There's people that will plan their weekends around our play, and we're very proud of that fact.
We have a board of 12 people, and it takes everybody's, you know, help, and everybody pitches in. It's teamwork, and it's a lot of times it's hard work, but you know, we volunteer, and that's why we're on the board, I guess, because we want to keep our theater here, and we're proud of it.
He had to go really badly, and he just started running up the stairs.
But this is a show to run.
Many of the foods we eat come from seeds, but who are the keepers of the seeds? Are older variety of seeds important? We'll explore those questions and more in a segment entitled Seed Savers from the Prairie Public North Dakota Humanities Council project, Key Ingredients.
Farmers have historically been the keepers of the seed and have been the plant breeders. Many of the varieties, for instance, in the Oscar Will catalog were varieties that were accessed from people, you know, native peoples. They were indigenous to this landscape, and native people had been cultivating them for hundreds of years.
The seeds were harvested in the fall, along with all the other, with the corn and the squash and the other vegetables. I used to watch my mother do this. She would select the strongest, firmest, straightest ears and set them aside. And like with the corn, they were specific for specific purposes. There was a softer corn that they used, and they ground. And when they ground that up, when it was ripe, they would roast it and then grind it and put it with tallow and berries, choke cherries or juneberries. The choke cherries they'd be ground up to, and they'd make corn balls. And those were food for when they went out and lasted them throughout the winter.
I want that one. Can you pick it for me? Wow, thank you.
Traditional gardening of the Nuwata or Mandan is almost gone now. There are elements of it left, and it'll just become an historical artifact.
The ideal situation would be to have all of our families again have gardens. I think many, many, many people do. But a lot of us are raising contemporary seeds. And I really believe that it'd be great to have another garden of traditional seeds. And I am encouraging all of our Indian people, if you have seeds, to dig them out, you know, see if they're good. You know, don't put them all in the ground, but put half of them in there maybe. You know, some of my earliest seeds are, the earliest seeds I have are listed as 1798 as my earliest batch I got, and I got 14 seeds. I haven't grown them in any place, I'm scared.
The selection process that we have done has been nothing more than what farmers and gardeners have done for millennia, and really is the base for all of the good food crops that we have today, is all the work that was done before us.
Basically, what I do on this farm is I grow and evaluate fresh vegetables, and I also run a small seed business, primarily heirloom seeds, and then more recently focusing on garden seeds on contract to seed companies and seed catalogs. So if I'm thinking, if my farm is to be sustainable, where the seeds come from is the number one thing that I'm thinking is a key to lead to sustainability. I'm not saying every farmer needs to raise his own seeds, although at one point in time that was a very common practice right where we're at out here in the prairies. Everybody saved their own seeds. If you look at all the old farmsteads, there's granaries and there's seed cleaners in those. But typically with the consolidation in the seed industry, not only in cereal grains, but in vegetables and everything else, there's been less seed saving. And some of that's due to patenting and laws that we have to abide by too. So I think one good way to look to be sustainable then is to be able to have seeds adapted and be able to continue. Because that farm can continue if you can continually harvesting seeds.
We developed seed production, organic vegetable seed production. It's been a passion of mine for many years, gardening and saving seeds, and I had developed some varieties in our garden, and so we just went with that.
As we develop more local and regional food systems and address the issues of food security, we also need to address the issues of seed security. That is, in fact, where our food comes from.
There was a time when seeds weren't patented, and it's really only fairly recent that they have been able to patent seeds or any life form. And my fears have been realized that it has resulted in consolidation in the seed industry and less choice for consumers.
Seed is relegated to being bought and sold, period. It cannot be shared, it cannot be saved, it cannot be freely distributed, and it denies people social, political, and economic access to seed.
I think it's very important to preserve the genetics found in older varieties. I think a lot of the old varieties of vegetables set the standard for quality, taste, and nutritive value, storability, all the things that were valued in times past. If as seed growers, seed selectors, seed savers, if we focus on those things, that produces good food for healthy bodies, for healthy spirits, and what more as a human community could we ask of our food? I think that's just a great thing to strive for.
The Polaris Experience Center tells the story of a company that's been an integral part of life in Rosseau, Minnesota for more than 50 years. From the second snowmobile ever made to historic photos, interactive video, and product displays, this self-guided tour through the company's history is quite a ride.
Now it's my pleasure to be on the Polaris team. You know, snowmobiling is a fascinating business, and I'm proud to be associated with the leader.
The company was started in 1945. Edgar T. and David Johnson had this idea to build hoists and derricks. In 1948, Alan T. joined them. They did a lot of blacksmith work, doing whatever they could to keep cash flow and keep the bankers away from the door. The company remained Hattin Hoist & Derrick until 1954, when it was incorporated as Polaris Industries. Polaris started in snowmobiles in 1956. From there on, things began to accelerate with snowmobiles, and the march was on for Polaris to bring snowmobiles into the future.
Today, it's quite a different company. It's a $2 billion worldwide organization. You go back into the early 50s, there was 20 employees. You've got 3,000, 3,500 employees now. It's drastically changed. It's changed from being a small town, locally owned company to a worldwide corporation.
The Experience Center came into being here in Rosseau because this is the birthplace of Polaris. There is so much memorabilia and memories and stories that exist right here in Rosseau. So it was decided to try to pull this all together and put together a way that you could experience Polaris beyond seeing it from the side of the road.
Polaris, for the man who likes to be first. Here's the snowmobile with the winning reputation.
We grew an industry, is what we actually did. We were outdoor people, so we were, first of all, let's make one for ourselves so we can get out there into the hunting areas and do some exploring. And then we started to branch out and do testing in various areas. In those days, we didn't have the clothing you have today. You had to tell people, you know, it's fun to go out there, even if it's 20 below zero, you can still survive. There was growing experience in all facets.
Snow Pro, the pursuit of excellence.
To racing fans, Snow Pro is thrills, excitement, speed. To Polaris, it is even more. It is the pursuit of excellence.
Racing was not just for promotion, but it also became a big part of the research and development effort within the company.
Polaris was probably the first company to commercialize the snow traveler. It wasn't just a vehicle for work, this was fun. And as they enjoyed it more and more for fun, they found ways to make improvements. Racing drove product development. It drove the advancement of many of the features that we have today, the durability, the performance. Polaris was pretty active in the late 60s in working with snowmobile clubs to develop trail systems, places to ride, warming shelters.
Polaris begins with a famous star engine, Tough. High performance, these professional stunt drivers depend on it.
Polaris had one of those rebuilding years coming up. So how do we get people to keep talking about Polaris? Polaris had an individual in marketing by the name of Ted Otto. He was a stuntman. He had worked with Evel Knievel. Ted came up with the idea of doing the thrill team as a crowd pleaser and get the crowds at the races to talk about Polaris and forget about who might have won that day on the racetrack. I remember the first night, Ned never done it. Larry Rugland jumped on the 1969 machine and he went around the loop that night. It was just fantastic.
It can skip a snowdrift or seven cars. But don't you try it. We just want to make a point.
300 machines a day, 1,500 machines a week, and the reputation of Polaris rides with every machine.
People that worked for us were very mechanical minded. They were from the farm. They knew what equipment was. They knew how to handle tooling and things like that. So they were very knowledgeable, and that was a big help. A lot of times we did not have enough money for payroll. That didn't make a difference to these people. They would still work just as hard. Christmas was coming. We wanted to do something for the employees. Edgar and I were pretty active in flying. We got some candy and would fly over the farm and I would drop a sack of candy. It probably created more goodwill than making payroll in time sometimes.
Polaris, and be really free.
Polaris free.
Polaris is more than just about building product. A lot of people that go through the Experience Center, they remember the early 60s of the snowmobiles. Not all those rides were good, enjoyable rides, but they were part of the experience.
We want them to feel part of the Polaris family. They are part of the Polaris family. This company would not exist if we didn't have customers who loved snowmobiling and who enjoyed the products. And that's what we want them to get when they come here, to leave here saying, I own a Polaris, but I also own a part of Polaris history and heritage and all of the years that have gone into what we have today.
Again, gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be on the Polaris team. Have a good year. And let's keep that red, white, and blue machine out front.
All of the members of the FM Symphony Orchestra, Woodwind Quintet, teach music education at Concordia College. They perform a wide variety of both classical and contemporary music. From coffee shops to high school auditoriums, they delight audiences with their light and joyful melodies.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Russ Peterson. I play bassoon in the Fargo Moorhead Symphony Woodwind Quintet. The members of this group are Deb Harris on the flute, Lee Wakefield plays the clarinet, his wife Karen Wakefield plays the French horn, my wife Jennifer Peterson plays the oboe, and I, of course, play the bassoon in this group. We all play in the Fargo Moorhead Symphony together, as well as we all teach at Concordia College in Moorhead, Minnesota together.
Thank you for joining us for this edition of Prairie Mosaic. If you know of an artist, a topic, or an organization in our region that you think might make an interesting segment, please contact us at prairiemosaic@prairiepublic.org. For Prairie Mosaic, I'm Bob Dambach.
Prairie Mosaic is funded by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4, 2008. The North Dakota Humanities Council, a nonprofit, independent state partner of the National Endowment for the Humanities. The North Dakota Council on the Arts. And by the members of Prairie Public.